This is Brent Meyer from Strangelove, and you are listening to the New Wave Music Podcast.
Well, hello there, and welcome back to the New Wave Music Podcast. As always, this is Steve.
And this is T-Bone.
So, T-Bone, can you believe we've been doing this podcast for a little over 3 years now?
3 years?
My, as time has flown.
Yes, it has.
And just a reminder, why we do the podcast is to really spotlight new music from your favorite New Wave bands that have new material out. Hopefully, you guys have found some gems of an album in these last 3 years of doing this.
Right, yeah, those albums, these new albums are not being played on the radio for the most part. And so, yeah, we wanted to make sure that those albums are getting some recognition.
Yeah, and we also, as you guys know, we also do try to do interviews our best that we can to get those, and occasionally music news. And once in a while, we'll spotlight some newer New Wave bands, which we kind of get back on track on that one maybe just a little bit.
Yeah, and we also wanted to thank one of our listeners in Sugarland, Texas. We really appreciate you guys listening to us down there.
And as always, if you like this podcast, you can always leave us a tip. You can do so at buymeacoffee.com/newwavemusic.
Right, so Steve, why don't we go ahead and start on our next review?
Sure, T-Bone, I'm really excited for this one. We're going to be listening to the new album. We're taking a review of the new album from Public Image Ltd. You may remember them from such hits as Rise. They put a hot wire to my head because of the things I didn't say. And make these feelings go away. But I'll see this in every way. In the road, rise with you. In the road, rise with you. In the road, rise with you. Disappointed. And Seattle.
Yeah, so this album is called End of World, and it just came out recently here in 2023. So, Steve, this is the 11th studio album from the band, and this is just follows up from What the World Needs, which came out in 2015. Of course, with the band, we have John Lydon on vocals, Lou Edmonds on guitar, and Bruce Smith on drums. Now, both of those have been with the band since 1986. And then we have the baby of the band, Scott Firth. He is on bass, and he began in 2009.
Awesome. Well, T-Bone, let's see how End of the World sounds. Let's jump into the first track, Penge. I'll see you there. They'll be seeing me. Early morning in the fog, the death and misery. Welcome to Penge. Welcome to Penge. Welcome to Penge. I love the tempo on this track to open up the album. It does a great job coming across kind of like a pirate or almost like a Viking-like fight song. And how we get Johnny's signature higher pitch vocals coming in that are also just mixed into his lower vocal pitch, which works perfectly. Everything on this track worked for me. And the lyrics do an outstanding job of pulling you into the story that Johnny and the company are delivering. This is easily one of the best Public Image Limited songs we've heard in a long time. And one of the album highlights.
Yeah, couldn't agree with you more. A wall of guitars opens up the album before Lydon, sounding as good as ever, comes in. He uses, along with the voice that we're used to, a bit more of a deep guttural vocal to create a bit of mystery and gloom. And that, with excellent musicianship, starts this album just as we'd hope. And, Steve, as a side note, Penge is a suburb of southeast London.
Let's move into track number two, End of the World. This one opens up with some quick percussions and jumps into some great guitar work. Johnny's vocals still sound great as always after all these years. To me, though, it was the music melody that really pulled me into this frenzy of a song.
Yeah, you know, you mentioned percussion. This one starts off with a very irregular drum beat, followed by some screeching guitars opening the song. They make for a real potent combination, and then throw in a strong bass line, and sonically, this is a masterclass in musicianship. Lydon almost seems like a secondary element to the music, and midway through, though, he's given a chance to be a real part of this song before the instruments take over again. So that takes us up to one of my favorite songs on the album. Number 3, Car Chase.
I like the lights in the car park. I like the way they spread them apart. Car chase.
Steve, what a fantastic song. This one probably reminds me the most of their band in their heyday. The guitars drive this song forward, and the bass is extremely strong, especially in the middle of the track where Scott is given time to shine. And Lydon's vocals are powerful. He sounds as good as ever.
Yeah, T-Bone, and this is actually, I think, the most recent single that dropped off this album, and Correct. It's got a great video to go along with it. The song opens with an infectious tempo that John's vocals just blend together perfectly into. The lyrics keep you engaged into the song. But the highlight is that guitar melody that will pull you into this track and not let go. Highly recommended on this song.
Absolutely. And that's going to follow up with the fourth track, Being Stupid Again.
Pretending again, you're being students again. Being stupid again. Well done, it's students again.
Now, if you know, and we've talked about this before about headphones, but I think if any song on this album benefits by listening on headphones, this is the one. And it's not so much that the sound moves from one ear to another, but it's simply the way that the main instruments are presented. Lydon's lyrics are, as usual, complaining about different things that he dislikes, though for the most part, they are entertaining, even if I don't always necessarily agree with them.
This track opens with some great bass work that's blended beautifully with some nice synths to open the track. The percussions deliver a great tempo. I really liked how the delivery of John's vocals, how he can deliver these lyrics, something I feel like only Johnny can do, especially when they change on, like, when the phrase, give peace a chance.
Give peace a chance!
It's just another little small highlight on the song that makes it a very enjoyable song. And that's going to move us to track number 5, Walls.
All of these walls, so lovingly surrounding you. The martyrs are morons to the hereafter. If slaughter you're after, you'll get your disaster. And all of these walls, do they impound you?
The bass work mixed with John's spoken word dialogue make this track shine. The vocals do change a bit, though, when you hit that chorus for a great delivery. It's another track I found myself really enjoying. In fact, I can't tell you the last time I enjoyed a Public Image Limited album this thoroughly into it. So far, 5 tracks in, and all 5 tracks, I'd give a solid recommendation.
Right, absolutely. Yeah, this one really has a change of pace with it musically. At times, it has a bit of a jazz sound. And Lou's guitar playing is some of the most precise on the album. There's no screeching guitars or overwhelming drums on the track, and it's a wonderful change that creates a different sound that is present for the rest of this album.
Well, T-Bone, let's see how we feel about track number 6, Pretty Awful. I like how each track on this album has sounded unique, and this one is no exception. It opens up with some great dialogue from Johnny to set up the song. I enjoyed how the guitar slowly makes its way, along with some various other instruments, and then the vocals slowly build to that delivery of the chorus. It's another track I found myself getting pulled into and humming along to it on the first listen.
Yeah, you know, you mentioned the guitars. For me, it's Scott's bass that is the highlight of this track. It's steady and has a fantastic groove to it. And Lydon gets to show off his biting sense of humor on this song. And the chorus is probably one of the most melodic that the band has been in a long time. So that'll take us up to the seventh track, Strange.
Between the lines, there is the evil, that jealous fate. Before you reason, life's strange. Life's strange. Life's strange.
The band keeps a mid-tempo approach on this track, and while it has worked on other songs, I don't know that this is really one of the strongest on the album. The bass work is pretty good, but Lou isn't given much work to do with his guitars. There is a haunting synth line, though, that does create a nice effect.
Well, Tebow, and I do agree with you. This one did have a great tempo to start off the song. So far, really, all the songs have a unique tempo, and I think that's a highlight so far on the album. And I don't know how you can go wrong with a song with lyrics like, I had a run from the lizard demon. I mean, how could that not pique your interest? This one does feature some great vocal delivery from John and some great bass work. It's not my favorite track on the album, but still well worth a listen.
Oh, absolutely. So number eight track next is Down on the Clown.
Clouds again. Clouds of pain and shame.
So to me, Steve, this one sounds like it has an electronic drum beat, which is not a problem. Bruce is a fantastic drummer, but a different sound is certainly always welcome. The other instruments, especially the bass, accompany that beat wonderfully. This track has an interesting beat to it, and Lou's guitars pierce the sound in an unexpected way.
Yeah, you're right. This one does feature another kind of bass or percussion tempo. I did like that subtle use of the guitars throughout the song, and John's vocals are what we've come to expect on the album. But I will say, T-Bone, this is going to probably be my skippable or forgettable track on future listens. Again, it's not a bad song, but it's nothing like the quality of songs that we've heard to start off this album. And that's going to move us to track number 9, Dirty Murky Delight.
Like feeding all the weeds, like dealing in disease, like spit in the breeze, so eager to please. When you go digging in the dirt, you'll be down in the hurt.
A dirty, murky delight.
Dirty.
While Lincoln, you know it ain't right. She's not all there.
I enjoyed the way this track kicks off, from the light guitar riff and stripped down drums to how John's vocals are delivered on this. I also enjoyed how John is doing his own, kind of doing up his own backup vocals that come in with, or when he says the word dirty.
Dirty.
I'm happy to say this album seems to have gotten back on track.
Yeah, you know, I felt this is a really interesting sonic change on this song. I would say that it's probably the most unique on the album. That funk from the previous track, though different in a number of ways, continues with this song. And Lydon seems to be having a lot of fun with the goofy lyrics. And while they are a bit silly, they still work with the style of the song.
And that's going to take us to track number 10, The Doodat.
Now I won't do that, then I won't do this, then I won't do that, then. But she said this, and I said that, and yet you know, and that is that. Can you do that? Do to do that? Can you do that? Do that? Do to do that? Can you do that? Do to do that? Can you do that? Do that? Do to do that?
Again, this is another track that nobody but John could pull off. I really enjoyed how the lyrics are delivered perfectly with John's vocals. The instrumentation that accompanies this track does a good job of accompanying this John's vocals, but not becoming a distraction.
You know, the highlight of this song is the clapping beat that takes place at different times during the track. It's a fantastic way to make the unusual beat work even better. And the Daffy lyrics also continue, just like on the previous song, but they are certainly fun to follow along. So that takes us up to the 11th track, LFCF.
You're all liars, fakes, cheats, and frauds.
You're all liars, fakes, cheats, and frauds.
You're all liar, liar, faker, faker, cheats, and frauds.
Liars, fakes, cheats, and frauds.
Liars, fakes, cheats, and frauds.
The band slows things down just a little as we get closer to the end of the album. The bass is the focus on this one, but some unusual synths are also employed. They almost seem a little out of place, but are interestingly enough not to be annoying. And Lou's guitars gash in and create a sharp counterpoint to the steady bass. And just so you know, the title, which stands for Liars, Fakes, Cheats, Frauds, is something that we would expect to hear from Lydon.
Yeah, Timon, this one kicks off with some outstanding bass work and a very memorable guitar melody. This is one that all I'm going to say for me was an album highlight. I loved everything from the musicianship to John's vocals to the wonderful lyrics that slowly build up to the peak of the song. It's one that's going to be stuck in your head for days and have you humming along or singing along. Liars, Fakes, Cheats, and Frauds. And that's going to move us to track number 12, Northwest Passage.
Gotta take a Northwest Passage. This one not over. By the end of the night.
I didn't know what to expect on this track, but the howling that kicked this track off was something I never would have expected. This one again features some tight bass work, percussions, and guitars. It is a track that I think I enjoyed musically more than vocally. But it also goes on just for a tidbit too much for my taste, in my opinion.
Well, it's funny you'd say that. I think you're reading my notes this time. Yeah, you know, every album seems to have one, but I think that this is the one on End of World where I found the music more interesting than the vocals or lyrics. Lydon certainly does his best, but there's nothing particularly wrong with what he's doing, but the bass and guitar especially are what makes this song work for the most part.
And that's going to take us to the final track, track number 13, Hawaii. Close out the album with a beautiful ballad John wrote to his wife Nora, who was suffering from Alzheimer's. Unfortunately, she did pass away shortly after this song and before the album was released. But the lyrics on this song are nothing short of sheer beauty. You can feel the passion behind John's voice. This is not only an album highlight for me, but I would say it's a career highlight from John and Company.
Yeah, you know, there is a significant haunting effect to what John has done with this song to close out the album. It's both a beautiful love song to his late wife, but also an amazing experiment with pace, tempo, musicianship, and his nostalgic approach to the time and events, moments so memorable to him. There are a number of things that I liked about the previous effort, Steve, What the World Needs, but this album takes what they did and adds to it, adds a lot to it. The band have been working so long with each other, I have to assume they know what and where the others are going, and it shows. This is a tight album with only a few minor flaws. Great musicianship at the top of their game, and a leader in Lydon who knows what he wants to say. Steve, I've already placed this one in my top 10 for the year. Needless to say, this one gets a high recommendation from me.
Well, the last time I bought a Public Image Limited album was back in 1992, and that was the album That What Is Not. I remember it to be a very unbalanced album, kind of put me off a little bit from the band. I stuck to what I heard from the hits, but that was about it. End of World is an album that, for the most part, delivered a very solid listening experience. The solid tracks on this album make it one I would highly recommend for the hardcore and casual fans of Public Image Limited. T-Bone, I do agree with you. This one has found a spot in my top 10.
Nice.
How high it's going to go, I don't know yet. We'll find out in a few months from this recording. But I, again, highly recommend picking this one up. You will not be disappointed.
All right, so is that time for some music news? The Church has released a new single, Realm of Minor Angels.
So no more approach in these cards or on the loans. Don't bother crying. I know you're lying.
This will be included on an extended release of The Hypnagogue.
Well, it's been quite some time since we've heard from Billy Bragg, but he just released a new song inspired by Oliver Anthony's viral single, Richmond North of Richmond. And Billy's song is called Richmond Earning North of a Million.
It comes down to the self same thing if you're black or white or brown. Richmond earning north of a million. Wanna keep the working folk down. Wanna keep the working folk down.
And Duran Duran have announced their release of their 16th studio album, Dance Macabre, due out on October 27th. The album not only features a batch of new songs, I believe there's three new ones, but also a number of covers, including tunes by Billie Eilish, Talking Heads, The Rolling Stones, and more. The band has also shared the title track of this album, Dance Macabre, as a lead single.
And T-Bone, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe Andy Taylor actually worked with him on a few songs as well, those three
songs.
He
did. Yeah, absolutely. He's back with the band. You know, like I say, he's had some medical issues, some health issues, and he did work with them on this one.
So T-Bone, what would you say if I told you that Gordon Gano has created a rock musical?
I would not be surprised in many ways.
The musical is called Run, Bambi, Run. For the last few years, Gordon Gano has been working with on this musical with Academy Award winner Eric Simonson. And it's coming to the Milwaukee Respiratory Theater this fall. You can kind of get a sample of what you're in for in the track, Why Does It Always Gotta Be Me?
Why does it always gotta be me? I wasn't doing nothing. We weren't doing nothing. We weren't smoking nothing. We weren't pulling nothing. Well, everyone does something just to try to have some fun. A little something, something. I'm not the only one. But why does it always gotta be me?
And Dave Stewart has revealed that his Eurythmics bandmate, Annie Lennox, is done with touring. The acknowledgement came as Stewart announced concert plans celebrating the 40th anniversary of the band's 1983 breakthrough album, Sweet Dreams Are Made of This.
Well, T-Bone, I know at the time of recording, we're still several months outside of Christmas, but as far as I'm concerned, Christmas came early. We got a brand new single from OMD called Bauhaus Staircase. Going to be from their upcoming album that will release in October of 2023 called Bauhaus Staircase. And you bet we'll do a deep dive on that album in a future episode.
Absolutely. Yeah, and Collin Hay dropped a new single, Into My Life.
A wicked smile that you flash as you walk through my door. Into my life.
The song existed as an album track and live show favorite until it exploded in Brazil in the 90s as a theme song to the popular soap opera, and I'm bound to butcher this, Rana do Cicada.
I think that should do it for the music news. How about we jump back into our album review?
Absolutely. So up next is going to be the latest album from Glen Matlock. Now, you may remember Glen as a member of the Sex Pistols. They had songs such as God Save the Queen. Anarchy in the UK.
Your future dream is a sharpened skin cause I wanna be anarchy.
And he's also done solo work before, and he had a song called Sexy Beast.
Sexy Beast.
Now, as I mentioned, Glen was the original bass player of the Sex Pistols, writing some of their best-known songs before he was sacked and the job was given to the far less talented Sid Vicious. After that, he went on to form other bands and became a much sought-after journeyman for different bands. And Steve, this album has, of course, Glen Matlock on vocals, guitar, and bass. And then we have a plethora of well-known names that worked with him. So we have Clem Burke on drums. He's with Blondie. Chris Mosto, also on drums. James Holloway on keyboards. He's from The Waterboys. Neil X on guitars. He is from Zig Zig Sputnik. Earl Slick on guitars. He's been with many bands, including the New York Dolls, and Norman Watt Roy on bass. And he was with the ska revival band, The Selector.
All right, T-Bone. Well, like probably most of our audience, I'm really unfamiliar with Glen Matlock. I'm jumping into this just for the review. How about we get things started?
Let's do it.
The opening track on the album is called Head on a Stick. The album kicks off with an outstanding rockabilly track. If you're like me, you're unfamiliar with the vocal stylings of Glen. This is a great song to not only open up the album, but to introduce you to Glen. This features some great guitar work that blends beautifully with Glen's vocals, some great lyrics. This track is also going to be one that's going to be stuck in your head long after hearing it. And without question, T-Bone, this is the album highlight for me. I'm not sure where the album's going to go from here, but so far I'm really liking this first track.
Yeah, you know, this one starts off with a real rocker. Bass and drums are most prominent, but also with outstanding guitar. Matlock, you kind of just said this, Steve, but Matlock isn't someone that you know for his voice, but he starts off this album with confidence and vocal power. This is a hard rocking song that is bound to set the tone for the rest of the album.
And that takes us to track number two, Consequences Coming. This track kicks off with some great vocals and guitar work. I thought the use of clapping to accompany the percussions was a nice addition. This is one that didn't quite have the impact that the opening track had on me, but I still found it to be a very enjoyable listen.
Yeah, you know, Matlock has a bit of a gruff voice in general, but on this one, especially during the chorus, he comes off a little smoother. The pounding drums accompanied by heavy bass are the highlight for me, but to say that the guitar work isn't important would be a mistake. They all work together. Next up on the third track is Magic Carpet Ride. Now, Steve, this track starts off with a real change of pace. It has a little bit more of a surf rock blues tone, and it makes a great different sound, one that I didn't expect. The backing vocals during the chorus really enhance the vocals from Glen. This is probably the most contrasting style of song sonically that we've heard so far.
I was thrilled to discover that this track was not a cover of Steppenwolf's Magic Carpet Ride. All kidding aside, I really enjoyed this track. It kicks off with some great percussions. And again, that clapping to accompany the music blends perfectly. Glen's vocals, I felt, worked really nice on this rockabilly track. It also features a great guitar solo. But like you mentioned, when that chorus kicks in, it might have just have become my second favorite track on the album.
You know, and speaking of favorite tracks, we're up to number four. It's one of my favorites, Speaking in Tongues. Steve, first off, yes, cowbells.
And now I know why it was your favorite track.
Exactly. You can't go wrong with cowbells. It also has incredible bass, drums, and guitar opening this track. And the changes in pace at different points of the song are a great way to keep the track interesting, unique, and powerful. A guitar solo midway through really kicks the song into high gear. Add in some cool backing vocals, and you have one of the better songs on this album.
As you mentioned, this track does kick off with some cowbell. It's blended into some great musicianship. And again, once that chorus hits you, you're going to be pulled into this rocking song. I also found that the guitar work added some good highlights to this track as well.
Yeah, and the next track is number five, Shine Off Your Shoes.
Yeah, what they say, that what goes round must come around, but you're wiping the floor, women wiping the floor. I got to give you dues. I said you're wiping the floor, women wiping the floor. So it takes a shine off your shoes.
So, Steve, if any song on this album gives more of a blues sound, and many of them do, I think this is the one. It's the guitars, which hide a bit in the background for most of the song, that probably create that effect, but then they're brought right to the foreground. And Matlock gives everything into this track vocally as well.
This is one that I will say Glenn's vocals are clear and deliver some great lyrics. But I'm also starting to notice with this track that it's starting to kind of sound a bit of like what we've already heard thus far on the album. And unfortunately, this is a forgettable track for me. Let's move on to track number 6, Constant Craving.
Here, beneath my skin. Oh, here I say constant craving. As I always been.
The sound, vocal, and pace are mixed up from what we have heard. Also, the vocals of Glenn are a little bit coming a little differently as well from what we previously have heard. After the last track sounding so much like it was blended together from the first tracks of the album, the change in this sound in this track was a very nice way to pull me back into the album.
Yeah, you know, and I really enjoyed this song. It's one of my favorites on the album. The guitars that start this track are maybe some of the best on the album. They are smart and perfectly played, but it's Matlock's vocals that really shine. He sounds great. But going back to those guitars, they just fit so well into the song. The bass and drums are equally perfect, creating a wonderful track that has everything you could possibly want.
Let's see how we feel as we move into track number 7, Step in the Right Direction. I enjoyed how this one opens with the chorus of the title of the song, along with some tight guitar and percussions that were a step in the right direction for me on this track. Unfortunately, this song is one that I got bored with halfway in, and again, found this one to be another one of those tracks I'd call a throwaway song.
Yeah, I think we're kind of feeling the same way about this album at this point. The pounding drums really send this song in the right direction, no pun intended. This is a little bit more of a standard rock and roll song that we've heard previously on this album, but the musicianship is so good that a more basic track in most parts can be forgiven. And that takes us up to the 8th track, Something About the Weekend.
Look at me.
Once again, excellent guitar work and another track with some hard drumming. But as you've said on the previous few tracks, Steve, I do have to say that despite the outstanding playing, tracks are starting to meld into each other. As we've come to the middle of the album, there is a lack of distinguishable difference in the sound of the songs. My thoughts are that I hope it can recover.
Well, Timon, this is another track that I found to be just okay. It might be worth a listen, as Glenn's vocals and the musicianship do make for an enjoyable listening experience. But as T-Bone, you've said in the past, this track just does not have a re-listenability factor for me at all.
So that'll take us up to the 9th track, This Empty Heart. The vocals, including the backing singers, are probably the highlight of this track. Matlock sounds especially good. Sadly, though, the instrumentation is not as exceptional. It's good, but nothing that really stood out for me.
I liked how the pace and tempo were mixed up from what we have been hearing. This one comes in at a slightly higher tempo, and it kind of works to pull my interest back into the album and see what we have in store going forward, which will take us to track number 10, Facing the Crowd. Deep into this album, we actually come across this track, which is actually a highlight for me on this album. I'm not sure if it has something to do with it. It sounds completely different enough from what we've heard, and that la 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 chorus made it for a very enjoyable listening experience.
Yeah, you know, it's a real change of style and tone on this song that helps bring the focus back to the album. The chorus is not only catchy, but fun to listen to, and Glenn seems to be having an enjoyable time with his singing. The instrumentation, though, I didn't feel it was the best on the album, still works, but doesn't have the same punch as some of the other tracks. Now, late in the album here on track number 11 is actually one of my favorites, Tried to Tell You.
Too fine and dandy.
A complete and welcome change of pace with a doo-wop song, and finally we have a track on the second half of the album that is exceptional. The vocals and the backing work perfectly together, and the piano, which I think is the first time used here, really creates the mood. In addition, fantastic guitar work really comes in midway through and gives the song just what it needs.
Yeah, things do slow down on this album for this ballad. The tone or the way the song is presented definitely reminds me of a song you'd hear from the 50s, 60s. Glenn's vocals work, again, blended with that piano, which was a very much welcome addition, work very well for this semi-Western ballad. And that's going to take us to track number 12, Can't Be Myself With You.
Man,
we get back into the rockabilly tempo with this track. I really like the lyrics on the track. I did like the lyrics and how Glenn's vocals deliver them onto this track. And they also, that guitar work, again, provides some nice highlights on this song.
You know, for me, sadly, after such an engaging and amazing track, we're back to one that is certainly serviceable, but doesn't expand on the sound that we've already heard so much. Musically, I also found it a bit lacking. Once again, no instrument stands out, which isn't something that makes this album a great one.
Well, let's close off the album with track number 13 called This Ship.
Ain't a card, no one knows right now. Look out, I'm gonna watch my back. This ship, I said the ship has already. This ship, I hear the ship's already. This ship, I said the ship has already sailed. Ah, yeah.
We end the album with a good rock song. Again, it features some strong lyrics, and Glenn's vocals are once again consistent. This track, I wish, would have come sooner on the album. As Tivo, I'm going to say that this probably is my third favorite song on the album, but it's also very deep into a very low, it feels like a long album.
Yeah, no, I completely agree with you. You know, we're closing off this album with maybe a better track than what we've heard in the majority of the second half. Matlock really sounds great, and the instrumentation overall is quite good.
Well, T-Bone, as I said prior to this review, I had no clue who Glenn Matlock was. The best way to describe this album for me would be when you go to a concert and you sit through an opening act, you have no clues who they are and what to expect.
That's a good analogy.
It's an unbalanced album. It has some highlights. It also has some tracks that went on way too long and were very forgettable. Kind of like when you see an average opener, you pick up maybe like one or two of their hits. That's what I recommend. If you like one or two of these songs, pick those up as singles or digital downloads. But I'd skip the rest of the album as I found it to be kind of more tedious and a chore to get through.
I love a good synth song, but sometimes I want something a bit more traditional with powerful guitars, bass, and drums. That is this album. Here, Matlock has done a political album, not only concerning what is going on in his home country, the UK, but also here in the US. But I wouldn't have known that if I hadn't read it somewhere. And for me, that's actually a good thing. Highly obvious political songs have their place, but all too often they can prove ineffective. Unfortunately, and I completely agree with you, Steve, on this one, this album in many respects is hit and miss. There's a lot of good work here, very good, but it also goes on with the same type of sound far too often. Cutting down a few songs may have helped. So as a whole, I can only give this one a minor recommendation, which is a shame, as what I liked was well worth it.
Well, T-Bone, not going to lie, after 3 years, I'm glad that you're finally kind of coming on my taste of the music.
It was bound to happen.
But I'm curious what's going to happen on our next episode. We've got brand new music from Andy Partridge and the brand new album from Cindy Wilson we're going to take a listen to.
Yeah, Andy Partridge, of course, from XTC, and Cindy Wilson from the B-52s. And so, yeah, if you have any questions or comments that you want to give to us, shoot us an email. We'd love to hear from you. newwavemusicpodcast@yahoo.com.
If you've heard the Public Image album, you've heard Glen Matlock, we'd love to hear your take on it. See if we were, how far off the mark we were, if we hit it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I'd love to hear what people thought about those two albums. And then of course you have our social media, Facebook and Instagram. Thanks for listening. We look forward to talking to you next time.